Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. Once again, I have this opportunity that EWTN gives me to enter into your home, to introduce to you someone who, drawn by the workings of the Holy Spirit in their heart, has been drawn home to the Catholic Church. It's always a good pleasure to do that. And our guest tonight is Jay Lampert. He's listed as a revert, former evangelical. We'll find out more about that in a moment. But Jay, it's good to have you on the
Marcus,
program.
It's a pleasure to be here.
You came here from Baltimore, right?
I did, yes. Yes, and I'm recently, this is a fairly new show to me, and it's really been a blessing to have this. I listen to the podcast when I'm at work, and it's really been a blessing to have it, so.
Yeah, you didn't know it was a TV show, did you?
Not at first, no. I said I got a great face for radio, so I was a little nervous about being on the set here, but it really is an honor to be here.
Well, Jay, it's good to have you here.
Share the seat with guys like Scott Hahn.
Well, it's good to have you here. Yeah. And let me get out of the way as quick as I can and invite you to go back and start at the beginning and let us hear about your spiritual journey.
Great. Yeah, so I was a cradle Catholic, and I absolutely loved my faith growing up to the point where I was the youngest altar boy in our diocese for a period of time. I think that's changed now, but I wanted to serve Mass. I just had this desire to do it, and I spoke to our altar board director. He said, you know, we're going to have to get permission from Archbishop McCann. He said, why don't you write him a letter? So I wrote him a letter, and when he came out to the church, he said, okay, we'll let you do it. And I was the youngest altar boy in the diocese. When Monsignor Burns passed away, I was asked to lead the procession with the cross, and Sister Joseph came up to me afterwards and said, you know, he wanted you to have his rosary beads. There was just, I really had an affinity for the Catholic Church. Oh. And the neighborhood we lived in, I grew up in New York, and I lived in Queens for a while with my grandparents. It was very, very all in the family, much like art imitating life for us, or life imitating art, however you want to look at it. And just the neighborhood we lived in, it's like it almost smelled Catholic. You could smell the sauce seeping out of the plaster walls. It was like the incense for the house, right? And well, there, through a set of circumstances, and this is usually how it goes, and I won't get into all of them, there were some issues that came up. I was serving a high-profile funeral for a firefighter who passed away, and the incense coals got wet, and they didn't light, and this was right after All Saints Day, and we had an altar boy that came in with a pentagram spray-painted on the back of his head.
Whoa.
And yeah, and that just disrupted the whole altar board program was just in disarray after that, and they thought it was done deliberately, and they said, you know, we're going to suspend you for a while. And I said, you know what, I'm done with this. So I was done serving Mass, and
wait,
I was...
you didn't realize this person would have come like that, right?
Pardon me?
The person with the pentagram.
Oh, during the Mass. Like, yeah. he wore a hat in a church and took it off, and I still don't know what that was all about.
Right.
There was a lot of... It was a very confusing time.
But for you, it must have been like the last straw of a variety of things.
Yeah, that was
discouraged you.
And there was another incident too. We had shortly after Father Burns passed away, we had a priest that came from India, and he was great. We got along really, really wonderfully, and he became very friendly with our family, and we would actually let him stay at our house. And you know, he was getting gifts from my sister and I, and it was, you know, it seemed great to us, and then he just sort of disappeared. And I didn't quite understand exactly what transpired there, but a few years later, my mother explained to me, and I mean, my mother is, believe me, she's a saint. Like, this was completely innocent thing, but apparently he had sent her a ring from India, and with the, you know, there's my dad in the house, right? Like, yeah. And I don't know what his intention was, but she said, yeah, we can't have anything to do with him anymore. And that was another confusing. Yeah. Confusing element to all of this. And then my grandfather passed away. We sold our house. We moved to Pennsylvania. And this was culture shock. So here you got this kid who's been in Catholic school for 8 years, right? Wearing the same uniform every day to school. I mean, I had plenty of material for a therapist, right? Like, oh yeah, my mom has to dress me for school because I don't know what to wear. I had a hard enough time picking out an outfit for today. I still have trouble dressing myself. And I'm in this community where Catholicism is not really... It's not really entrenched in the culture like it was in the neighborhood where I lived. You know, there were statues of Mary everywhere and just churches on every block and the Feast of St. Anthony and all these things going on. This wasn't the case. I mean, we had a little parish that we went to, but I was already mentally checking out. And shortly after that, so then I started dating a girl who was, her family was Baptist. And I got my first taste of a Baptist church. And again, this is coming off the tails of all of these incidents that have taken place. And just, I'm at an age where I'm very impressionable. Mm-hmm. And I'm trying to figure a lot of things out. I'm still kind of dealing with the fact that, you know, I lost my grandfather and there were some other family issues that were coming up. And I went to this Baptist church. And I think when I walked through that door, you know, I had long hair and, you know, I'm the boyfriend, the Catholic. I was a project to them. They thought, all right, this is great. Big smiles on their faces. And I heard these messages about, it's a different message, different format. Yeah. I'm like, oh, I don't have to stand, I don't have to sit, I don't have to kneel. This is great. And I started to hear about this freedom in Christ. And it was an interesting thing to hear, but I wasn't ready to latch on to that. And it also was a little confusing because, I mean, and the girl, I mean, God bless her. I hope she's doing well today, but her and I together were not good. There was a lot of codependency issues there. We were not doing things we were supposed to be doing to keep it family friendly here. And then going to church on Sunday and hearing these Baptist messages. Yeah. It was just another very confusing message I was receiving. So I was able to kind of construe Bible verses the way they would work for me, and I, you know, it was kind of a fake it till you make it kind of a deal. But I wasn't ready to really do the sinner's prayer and go through the formula that the
Baptist church had set up for new people to come into the church.
Oh yeah, there was altar calls and all these different
exactly
things.
Right.
So I was working at a grocery store. Now fast forward a couple of years.
And, well, let's pause there then, because so you've kind of left your basic Catholic.
I showed up every Sunday with my parents, but then when I could, I would go out to this Baptist church in the middle of nowhere with my girlfriend's family.
All right. And when you look back on your childhood in the Catholic Church, you loved it.
Absolutely.
Every part of it.
Every part of it.
What was going on inside in terms of relationship to Jesus?
Yeah, you know, that was the thing. I had a deep conviction for Christ. I grew up in a family where we didn't use the Lord's name in vain. You know, and again, you see, and this is not to knock the Catholic Church, but in my neighborhood, you know, I remember down the street, you know, the lady be out in her nightgown, you know, ashing her cigarette into the Statue of Mary, cursing at us because we were in, you know, on the driveway, get out of my GD driveway, right? So later on in life, as I start to get around evangelicals and different ecclesiologies, I'm starting to see, well, wait a second, you know, there's something about them that's different, you know, and...
Yeah, but you. My question is that if you look back on your own self as a young man in the midst of the externals of the church, mm-hmm. which were very much a part of you, still, the reality of relationship with Christ had caught you young on. You would say,
yeah, I would say absolutely. Correct. Yeah, I had a fear,
so it wasn't
a healthy fear of the Lord.
Good.
You know, I knew He was always watching me wherever, you know, whatever I was doing, and all the bad decisions I made, I knew He was right there with me. So that was another very confusing thing, because despite that fact, I still did horrible things because I wanted to. Fast forward a few years after that, and now I'm in the phase of life where I had really long hair and I wore dashikis, and I talked about things like apartheid and Nicaragua, things that, you know, a white person from the suburbs has no business talking about. And I met this guy named Charlie Dagan. He was a truck driver, and he delivered our milk every day. And we would talk, and he's just a really nice guy, and just never judged me. You know, he was just, he'd always smile, he let me say what I was going to say, and he said, you know, I want you to come to, we're going to do a play at our church tonight, I want you to come. And if he had been a Buddhist or a Hindu or anything like that, I would have said, oh yeah, sure, I was open to anything, anything goes, right? Sure, let's check it out. So I went, it was called Heaven's Gates and Hell's Flames, and they did some really kind of corny skits, and there was a skit where there were two guys in their hard hats sitting on a phone pole, and obviously the one knows Jesus and the other one doesn't, and there's sparks and they die and they're standing at the gates of heaven, and the one guy goes to hell and the one guy goes to heaven, and they did the altar call, and I was like, ah, all right, you know, I got up, and Charlie was grinning from ear to ear. Yeah. He was thrilled, and he said, why did you do that? I said, well, I think I just want to reaffirm what I already believe. I mean, I remember saying that. I said, I need to reaffirm this because I never heard this way. And he said, that's wonderful. They gave me a Bible and they sent me on my way. And I felt great there for a couple of months, you know, but Again, still making bad decisions. Nothing really changed. And we'll fast forward another few years because we don't have an awful lot of time on this program. I met my wife-to-be. And we've been married for, we have three children now. And I met her on a camping trip. And we were playing folk songs together and singing and fell in love with her. And her and I got married, and she's got a Lutheran background, and no animosity toward the Catholic Church at all. And you know, her mother has been a great, just spiritual leader in my life. She's really, you know, she's always been, always had the right verses for me when I needed them. And her and I, we got married and found this nice little non-denominational church. We settled on. Oh, because I left this part out, you know, right before we got married, I found, I'm not going to say the name of the church, but, you know, I had walked away peacefully from the Catholic Church. Oh. But when I found this particular non-denominational church, that's when the anti-Catholic doctrine really started to, and I started to feel like I was deceived as a child. I said, you know, I started to believe that the Catholic Church was actually, they were worshiping, it was a form of witchcraft. And, you know, Mary was some white magic thing. I mean, I'm not going to get into all the details of this, but, you know, I was given books and tracts and all different kinds of literature. And I thought, oh, this is terrible. I got to get people out of this because they're just being led straight to hell.
I can remember that because when I was in youth ministry years ago, and we used to pull Catholic kids out of the Catholic Church. And one of the strategies you would say is, at home, who do your parents talk more about, Jesus or Mary? And if they said Mary, we'd say, see?
Yeah.
And we'd use that to do just what you're talking about that church did. It'd take little things and then kind of plant in your mind seeds, myths about the Catholic Church that aren't true, but they're kind of closed. You'd say, oh, yeah. Yeah.
Well, the one verse they used to love to interject in there was how Jesus comes with a sword. You know, like, you're going to have problems now with people because now you're in the truth. You weren't in the truth before, but now you are. I said, okay. So now the Bible was a weapon. You know, now I had to use it. Now I'm a soldier going out to battle, and my job is to get all these dumb Catholics to get in the truth. And they had to follow this particular formula, the John 3:16 sinner's prayer. You say these magic words, and you're saved. It's all done. And because I said them, and I was a completely different person. Yeah. So I thought, right? And I remember we get in circles to pray, right? I was on the worship team at this church, and everyone would be bowing their heads, and I'd be nervous. I'm like, oh, I don't know what to say. I'm not used to spontaneous prayer. So I would just listen to everyone, and I have my eyes open. Oh, it's my turn, you know, and this person said what I was going to say already. But I just started to slowly adopt the culture and learn the language and, you know, the hands up and all the stuff that goes on in the church. And thinking that this was all coming from in here, when really I was essentially adopting this culture.
You're adopting a new liturgy.
A new liturgy, exactly, yeah. So
just for those listening on the radio, our guest is Jay Lampert. And, you know, that's it really, there's so much truth in that. That this new liturgy, when a person jumps to a different tradition and they got to learn the ropes, you know, they got to learn what the new language is and what the new rituals are, right? And how do you fit in, right?
Yeah, and then I would ask questions like the unforgivable sin of the Holy Spirit and saying, what is this? And they would say to me, oh, well, yeah, you know, that's the verse the Catholics like to use to justify purgatory, but we don't believe that. Oh, okay, well, they really didn't answer the question, but that was good enough for me.
Yeah.
You know, so I always had an answer for everything now. And so anyway, years later, my wife and I find this really nice non-denominational church we settled on because she was never comfortable in this particular church. She just thought it was a little too much for her. And we became youth group leaders, and I spoke in front of the youth group about various issues, and it was wonderful. I mean, we were there, 10, 12 years. And then things started to take a little bit of a turn. I started to study the seven solas, and just in listening to some of these messages.
Explain that to the audience, the seven solas.
Well, it's sola scriptura, sola fide, you know, grace alone, scripture alone. This is essentially what the Protestant movement, right, started by Martin Luther. This is pretty much
the pillars.
The pillars. Thank you. Yes.
The pillars of the Protestant answer as they broke away from the church. In other words, it isn't the church; it's the Bible alone.
The Bible alone.
It isn't allowing. You're not praying to saints to help you. It's Jesus alone. It's not what you do in life, it's faith alone. So those are the
right. 1 Timothy 2:5, I think, says right. there's no intercessor between God and man. Right. Right? So, and that's an interesting verse because that comes up later as well. So I walked away from the church. I was experiencing a lot of bitterness and anger, and I think I never really resolved certain issues that I had had, you know, early onset issues, and they just came back up. And I can't tell you how many times I was baptized, how many times I did altar calls, just expecting different results. Yeah. You know, it's almost a definition of insanity, right? Just doing the same thing over and over and over. I always expected to get that feeling again, and maybe this is going to be the real one, or maybe this church has the right formula. I did a lot of church shopping, and what is this church doing? This church isn't doing. But then I started to think about the scripture alone. And again, like, how can all of these churches, we believe the same thing, and yet we're all arriving at different conclusions. And it's maybe 40 or 50 verses that are really the major discrepancies, but this is enough to divide us. I did something on the plane on the way over here, Marcus. Like, I did a Google search on this. There was 30,103 verses in the Old and New Testament, and then I think there's 100 and some that aren't documented in those verses. If you were to assign a unique verse to every single denomination that was out there, you would only get through 75% of those churches before you'd run out of verses. That to me indicates a little bit of a problem, you know? Yeah. And I really started to question what I believed. And I said, you know, I'm going to take myself out of church for a while because I need to know if I really believe this or if I'm just going along with what's happening around me. So, and then I started to think about the church. Well, what is the church, right? We're the church. You know, you take a verse like, what is the verse for the 1 Timothy 3, right? The pillar of our foundation is the church. Okay. But what is the church? A lot of the Protestant churches, I believe, and this is not to knock them, but I think that they've created this esoteric term for what church is. We're the church. So it's no longer about the building. So I could show up in flip-flops and a t-shirt and, you know, listen to a concert and listen to a really good message and a PowerPoint presentation, and that's church. There's no reverence and there's no altar or place of sacrifice. And but that's good enough because all I need is scripture and scripture alone. So in that regard, I said, if all I need is a scripture on the church, I don't need to go to church. I can interpret this on my own. So I spent 2 years remodeling my basement and, you know, Sunday mornings. And my kids asking me, well, why doesn't Daddy go to church? You know, so while I'm down here doing some work. And I was just really angry. And I got to a point where, I mean, just through a whole set of ideas and philosophies, I just started to doubt whether I believed anything at all. I said, you know, maybe this whole thing is a farce. I started to think about the original scrolls and how they arrived to the interpretation we have today, the game of telephone, like who's King James, who is Martin Luther, you know, the Septuagint versus the Masoretic text. Like there's so much there, the Greek translation versus the Hebrew. And this book alone is going to change me internally. Like, it's made me very head smart now. Like, I know these verses, and I can spit them out, and I can use them as ammunition. I can use them to save people. But have I really changed internally in here? And the truth was, I didn't. And I read a book by Francis Chan. It said, and Francis Chan, as you know, is a Protestant pastor. And he said in the book, this line just changed me overnight. He said, if you were to take the Holy Spirit out of most churches today, they would continue to go on operating the same way. And that's it. He said, if you'd take the Holy Spirit out of me, I'd probably continue to go on using the same language and abiding by the same principles. But am I really changed in here? So I have to feel something internally. Otherwise, this is all make-believe. And it really got bad. This is the first time I ever doubted. I mean, I didn't doubt the existence of Christ and his divinity, but I doubted my salvation. I said, you know, how can I, is it once saved, always saved? Because I know I was saved. I know I felt something when I first said that sinner's prayer. But that feeling's since been gone. Yeah. And I have doubts now. And if I stood before the Lord, I don't know. I actually doubted my salvation. And it led to a lot of confusion. And, you know, I just wasn't a pleasant person to be around. It was very difficult, you know, my wife would tell you that I wasn't an easy guy to live with for a long period of time. I spent a lot of time working and just isolating myself.
Yeah, it sounds like you were saying that you were getting baptized over and over again because you were trying to get that feeling back.
I was trying to get the feeling back, and I was also trying to find the correct formula because, you know, I wanted to be right. You know, I wanted to be in the truth. And apparently, I wasn't finding it. And I wasn't, you know, I just saw the behavior of the people around me. I said, I want to be like these people. How come I'm not that way? Well, I'll just pretend to be like these people until I catch up. And, you know, my wife is, God speaks to my wife in ways that he doesn't speak to me. In fact, you know, like we have three children. She knew we were going to have a boy. And, you know, I just, it's just the way God works in her life. But so one night she told me, this is kind of sent a chill up my spine. She said, you know, I had a nightmare the other night that there was this old demonic man at the bottom of the stairs and he was just laughing. And I got terrified for a minute because I knew, I said, you know, I'm the one bringing this into the house. You know, I'm the one that my mind was going places that just, it just wasn't good. And, you know, I was actually getting ready to tell my family, listen, I don't know if I believe this stuff anymore. You know, I might just take a back seat. You know, I'll show up at church every week, but I don't know if I believe this. And something had to change. So that Christmas Eve, I'm sitting in my dining room, and I'm just, you know, my whole family's asleep, and I'm just looking at the Christmas tree, and I think I was just sitting there drinking a beer, reading a book, and I said, I'm going to go to midnight mass. Why not? You know, it was almost like just the last vestige of hope, right? I'm going to go to midnight mass. So got in the car, it was snowing, I drove down to St. Ursula's, it's a little parish down the street from me, and I was terrified, I was shaking as I was walking in there. I said, you know, I'm gonna walk into a place where they worship Satan. This is horrible. But then I thought about Romans 8, and I said, okay, you know what? I know I'm having doubts, but I said, regardless, nothing can separate me from the love of Christ. So I'm going in there knowing I'm wearing the armor of God, even though I doubted everything at this point, and nothing could separate me from that. So let's see what happens. So I grabbed the big wooden door, opened it up. You know, the smells hit me right away, and I was terrified. I sat down, and the reverence I saw in the people around me, the families, and everyone's holding hands during the Our Father, and I got a little lump in my throat, and I knew I had mortal sin in my heart, but I went up and I received communion anyway. And as I'm going up to receive communion, I'm thinking, okay, you know, this is the bread of death. Like, why am I doing this? This is it. I do this, and I just sold my soul away. Everything I believed for the past 12 years is just flushed down the drain. And I took the communion, and that night I went home. And for the first time in, I don't know, 12, 15 years, I slept in peace. I felt conviction. I felt guilt. Like, I didn't feel these things anymore. That was a problem. I thought to myself, I thought something Billy Graham had said once, where he said, you know, if you're not feeling guilt or conviction, then Satan's not worried about you anymore. You know, he's got you worried. And that was how I was feeling. I was like, you know, Satan's got me right where he wants me. You know, I don't feel anything. I started to feel bad again, which was good. I said, this is great. And just immediately just started to make some changes, make just different decisions. The way I talked, the way I treated people, the way I saw people. So I went back week after week, and my wife is going, what's going on with you? You know, I said, I'm just exploring, you know. I don't know. I don't want to rope you guys into this, you know. I'm not sure I really believe everything they're saying, but I'm going to keep going. So I kept going every week, and I was just going to a men's Bible study at the church where I was attending, Grace, and it's led by this guy, Pat Goodman. He's a wonderful
at the Catholic church.
No, this is at the evangelical church that we had gone to. Okay. I continued to go to this Bible study.
Right.
And I had this really good group of guys that I met with every week, and I was just started to share with some of them. I said, you know, I went to midnight mass at the Catholic church just to do it, you know, and I just to see what kind of reaction I was getting, just to get some jaws to drop. And a couple of the guys were a little like, oh, okay, but some of them were like, okay, that's good. So I just went back week after week, and sometimes I didn't tell my wife I was going to go. You know, I was just seeing, and they'd had the incense. I thought, oh man, you know, she's going to smell me when I get home. Maybe I should go to the bar and smoke some cigarettes to cover up the smell of the incense, because anything's better than that. And she had met this friend, Marianne Ringrose, who goes to our church now. And Marianne always showed up at her life whenever there was this crisis. You know, when we were having issues with children, I didn't want to have any more children, and she did. And Mary was always there right when she needed her. And she found out that Marianne went to this Catholic church. And Marianne's one of these people, when you speak to her, I mean, she just emits the love of Christ. She's just got it in her. And my wife was a little surprised to hear she went to a Catholic church. She said, "Where's this church you go to?" So she'd been wanting me to meet her for a while and just kind of have this conversation, because my wife Chelsea knew something was going on with me. And she came over to the house one time. It was for my daughter's birthday. It was almost a year ago today. A year ago, about a month ago. And we just started to have this conversation, you know, and I just started to tell her what was going on in my mind. And she said to me, "Well, Jay, it's a long journey. You know, it took me a while to get here." But she's like, "Why don't you just come to our church and check it out?" So I said, "Okay." So I showed up the next week, and Christ the King Church, it's part of the Anglican Ordinariate. We're based in Houston, Texas. Yep. I believe you had the diocese on, correct? Or from the Ordinariate.
Well, I've had Monsignor Steenson.
Monsignor Steenson, right, yeah. And it's this really small church, and getting the party, it was pouring down rain, right, during Lent. And I had my oldest daughter with me. I said, "We're just going to go check it out." And you know, I said, "You don't have to pay attention to anything. Just we'll go through this." Pouring down rain, and there's a giant banner they have hanging out on the front door. It says, "Welcome home." And I saw that banner, and I said, "That's it. I get it now. I get it." I walked in the door, and my heart just sank. I said, "This is it. This is what I've been missing." And I finally had my come to Jesus moment. The come to Jesus moment that I wanted to have all those years in the Protestant church, it finally came. Now, what I'm leaving out is that over the past several months, maybe years, I had been exploring a lot of ideas that I didn't realize were very Catholic. Now, I don't know if that was because they were indoctrinating me at a young age, or if this was just stuff that was just coming out of all the questions I had about sola scriptura and all that. But I had a lot of questions and ideas that were very Catholic. And when people started to knock the Catholic Church, I would defend it. I would say, you know, no, they don't pray to Mary. It's not a worship of Mary. Mary intercedes. You know, and then I did bring up that whole thing about there's only one intercessor between God and man. But I said, we're also called to pray for one another. So if there's only one intercessor, you know, we ask each other to bring our prayers to Jesus, and Mary can do that as well, and saints can do that as well. And that's in 2 Maccabees. We pray for the dead. But Martin Luther took that out. The Deuterocanonicals are not in the Protestant Bible. Why is that? So all these questions and all this stuff was coming up, and then I met Father Ed Meeks. He's the priest of the church, and he says, "Hey, you know, welcome. What brings you here?" And I said, "Well, I'm just kind of exploring this a little bit. I'm not sure." He says, "Hey, look, I understand." And this is a man who also revert, and you got to have him on your show sometime. Wonderful man. He was actually a Baptist pastor for a while as well, and came back to the Catholic Church. They were Anglican for a while. In 2012, they became officially Roman Catholic. And he says, "We should talk about that sometime." I said, all right. So I gave him my number, and you know, I saw that welcome home banner. I thought, oh boy, I hope that wasn't for me, you know, but it's up all the time. So I came back the next week and the next week, and then he and I finally sat down and talked, and he said, "You know, I did this catechetical teaching. You can get it on our website. Why don't you just download it and listen to it?" And the biggest issue I had at the time was purgatory. And so I said, that's the first issue I'm going to tackle. And I listened to it, and man, everything, that's it. I believe this. And then I went on to the other things, you know, and the just one issue after the other. I listened to him over and over again. And I went home and I told my wife, I said, "All right, that's it. I'm in. I'm sold." And we started to go to church as a family. And I think Easter was the first time I really felt like, okay, we're doing this. You know, we're back. And my wife was also happy to have us all together as a family at the church. And then, you know, I talked to Father Ed a little bit about, you know, communion. I listened to a teaching from Father Larry Richards about the Mass, and he talks about communion and how it is the bread of death if you have mortal sin in your heart, and the importance of confession. And I said, you know, and he had been saying for a while, I think you benefit from a good confession. I was like, well, we'll see. Maybe someday. So it was in June I had my first confession. And, you know, I'll never forget, he had me, my penance was actually just to reflect on the first Psalms, which to this day is one of my memory verses. And it was just amazing. When I walked out of there, I was just a completely changed man. He said, you know, you're going to notice a change in your in your family life, and I rejoice with you today in this. And I was like, okay. And it really, truly was, it was an overnight success. I mean, this was the feeling I had been trying to get all these years in the Protestant Church. And I came to Christ in the Catholic Church. So it was possible.
Well, let's pause there, Gene. Okay. It's a good place to pause. We'll take our break. We'll come back with a couple questions on that. Thanks, Gene. Okay. See you in a bit. Welcome back to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodaw, your host, and our guest tonight is Jay Lampart. And I paused you right in the middle of the journey. But you're in the church. Back home.
Yeah, we got the abridged version. I'm in the church and back home at the church.
And basically the last thing you said before we broke was you found that feeling, that emotional conviction of a relationship with Christ that you'd always been looking for, and you found it surprisingly the place you didn't expect it.
The last place I thought I would find it. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
Now, some might argue, no, wait, he just returned to that old Catholic culture that was what was nostalgic to him.
I heard that quite a bit. In fact, I'll tell you, anyone who's returning to the Catholic Church that's coming from maybe the background I had, I got a lot of free lunches out of it. I was getting phone calls all the time. Oh, can we meet for lunch? Can we meet for lunch? So it's a great opportunity to just get a couple of free lunches at least. But yeah, people would take me out to get my mind right, you know? And really, it just affirmed what I already believed. But what it comes down to is, I mean, I could beat you in the arena of ideas. You know, I could beat you in a debate, right? Until someone smarter comes along and then beats me. You know what I mean? It can't all be about what's up here. What's up here has to connect to what's in here. So what happened to me finally was, it was in here. You know, maybe it was in here all along, but I acknowledged it to the point where it gave me that conviction. You know, the healthy guilt, that the fear of the Lord, you know, the beginning of wisdom. It's the fear of the Lord, right? All of that in the last place I thought I would find it. And, you know, it's very humbling. It's almost like God has a sense of humor in that he really used the... It's amazing how that worked out, because it was very humbling for me, very humbling. In fact, we have a very good friend of ours. We had a small house church with, his name's Brian Glazer. And we were at their house and doing our small Bible study when we were back in the Grace Church. And looked out his window, and there was this stone pit. It looked like a barbecue or something. I said, what is that? I said, are you building a pit out there? He said, no, when we bought the house, there was a statue of Mary out there. And I said, well, where is it? And he's like, well, we didn't know what to do with it. So he's like, you know, we got rid of it. So I had a big smile on my face. I was like, well, what'd you do with it? He's like, well, he actually kind of felt bad about it. He said, well, we threw it away. And I started to laugh. I was like, well, that's great. I said, that's what you should do anytime you find something like that, because it's just garbage what they believe. And he was actually a little uncomfortable with my response. You know, he's like, that's a little awkward. Anyway, months transpire, and he and I are sitting in a Bible study, and we're just sharing things with one another. And he said to me, he looked right in my eyes, and he said, you know, Jay, he said, maybe, I guess it was some of the things I was saying, he said, maybe you need to go back to the Catholic Church. And I was like, what? You know, I was offended. I was floored. I said, how could you? You know, I'm in the club now. Like, I know the secret handshake. Like, you're asking me to go back there? You know, this is like asking a college student to go back to kindergarten. You know, what am I going to learn about Jesus from the Catholic Church? I said, you're out of your mind, man. And I was angry with him. You know, I didn't show it, but I was angry with him. But I was angry with myself. I mean, he was right. He was absolutely right. And he put the first bug in my ear to return. And, you know, like, he almost gave me permission to do what I thought was wrong all along. Because for me, it was always about, there was some hidden message, there was some hidden agenda behind the Catholic Church. You know, it wasn't about getting you to worship Jesus. It was about getting you to worship some other thing. You know, it was always something to see through. And, you know, The Abolition of Man, you ever read The Abolition of Man by C.S. Lewis? There's this great analogy in there where he uses a window. He says, the purpose of a window is so that you can see through it to something else. That's the purpose of a window. But to see through it to a garden or to a forest. But what if the garden or the forest were transparent? And you could see through that. And then you could see through the next thing. And then if you live in a wholly transparent world, then everything's invisible. And for me, really, the world was just becoming this, everything was a mirage. Everything was just designed to trick us into something. It didn't matter what it was. And what I saw when I walked into the Catholic Church was that everything pointed to Christ on that cross. You know, at the center of the church is the altar, the place of sacrifice. It really, I tell you, that the pivotal moment, because I was doubting whether I was making a good decision for my children here, was when we baptized our children. And we took them up to the altar. And there was this moment in the baptism where Father Ed took my son Charlie. And I think having a boy had a lot to do with this too. And
I mean, in terms of its effect on you.
Yeah, I think that had a great effect on me. And there he is. He's holding my son at the altar. And you know, I thought about Abraham. And you know, here's this guy, right? He lies to the Egyptians to protect himself. You know, saying that his wife Sarah's his sister. And then he hears a message from the Lord that he's going to have a child. He doesn't trust the Lord profoundly to the point that he sleeps with his wife's maidservant, right? And then they have Ishmael, who then goes on to, I mean, now we have the Islam, right? So here's this man, this fallible man, this really, by today's terms, horrific. I mean, if any of us did that today, forget it. We'd be all over the news, right? And what's he do? He obeys God, right? When God says, take your son Isaac and sacrifice him, he obeys God. So here I am, I'm thinking, I'm this, as human beings, right, we all just want to be loved. We all want to be right. That's it. At the core of it, we just want to be loved. We want to be accepted. We want to be on the winning team. But we get it wrong so often. And I just thought about all the things I had done, all the wrong decisions that I had made. And here I am, this imperfect person, and I'm offering my child. I'm taking my children to the place of sacrifice, right, where the Paschal mysteries pass through, and I'm saying, he's all yours, Lord. My kids, they belong to you. They don't belong to me. I'm going to screw it up. You know, I hear about so many people. I have friends that just, they go to card readers and do this, which is horrible. That shouldn't be done. And then they take their kids to church and they get them baptized and they go through communion. Well, you know what? Great. Because we're screwed up people. But in that moment, you're trusting that God is going to take care of them. You know, and look, Abraham's sins affected Isaac, right? I mean, Isaac repeated a lot of the sins of the father, so it's important for us to live righteous life. But that doesn't mean we shouldn't obey God. And that moment when Father had stood there with my son on the altar, it all came together. I had no longer any doubt that I had made the right decision. And I was 100% sold out.
It also reminded me also of the fact that you've experienced this reality of Christ in a place you never expected it.
Yes.
But in reality, and you wondered, had I ever heard it before?
Mm-hmm.
But what you were just saying there is you were reminded that the seed of your own baptism had come alive.
Right.
Had been there all along.
There's something to be said about that.
Yeah.
Now, we can argue that maybe, and I don't blame the Catholic Church for this, but maybe it was my age, I don't know, how I missed. Now, I don't necessarily think I missed the divinity of Christ. I understood that at a young age. But you take a verse like in Timothy, right, where the church is the pillar and the foundation of truth, right? I mean, that's true. You can't get around that. So the church in the sacraments offers everything we need for salvation. It does. It does. Because it leads us to Christ on the cross, which is John 3:16, right? The essence of the sinner's prayer. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son. And whoever believes in him shall not perish, but have eternal life. Now, we have everything we need in God's grace for salvation. Everything we need in the church. But they're not mutually exclusive. I learned that without having that understanding of God's grace, the sacrifice that was made on that cross in Calvary, everything in the church means nothing. And if I take the church out of that, then it's... How firm a foundation is that? Not very firm at all. I didn't do well on my own. So having both, having that understanding of God's grace and knowing that I'm forgiven, but at the same time also having the sacraments in the church and knowing that upon this rock, I will build my church, knowing that this is the foundation and the pillar for truth. It's wonderful, and we have to live that kind of sin. I have to anyway live that synergistically, and understand that in both those terms. And you know, people argue, well, you know, you're getting back to a church with a lot of corruption and blah blah blah. And I think about that Indian priest and all the stuff that happened. It's like, regardless, you could build a church out of stone, strong wooden walls. The possibility of a serpent slithering through is always going to happen. It's important for us. I think it's important for us as Catholics.
Well, that's what Jesus told us was going to happen. It's going to have wheat and tares and good and bad fish. You know, use the different analogies of the church. That's the church.
You know? Right. So I just remember, you know, going out to lunch with one of my friends, and they're telling me that, you know, you're getting yourself into something that's really not good. And I thought about it. I thought, again, about Abraham, you know? Yeah. The first time we ever hear about a petition for prayer in the Bible is Abraham. He's praying for Sodom, right? And he says, even if 50 good people in Sodom, would you spare this city? What does God say? Yeah. And then he keeps dropping the number just to check, right? I don't know the significance of those numbers necessarily, but I thought about it. I said, you know, let's just say, for instance, this person's right, right? And the Catholic Church gets completely corrupt over the... What's important is that we stand righteous as Catholics, you know, that we are connected to Christ. Because who has the keys to the kingdom, right? Who has the power to bind and loose that? And if we stand righteous before God, you know, if we are totally sold out and keep our compass pointed true north, then I believe we'll always be protected. And so for me, I can't speak for anyone else, but I know for me, you know, that's a constant conviction for me. And it's what keeps me grounded and my family grounded as well.
Well, you know, Jay, when I hear stories like yours, that reminds me how God really loves each of us in a very individual way. I mean, he loves us corporately as the church, but he loves each of us, and he knows what each of us needs. And sometimes we take what we've been given for granted, and he uses different ways to get our attention. For some, for like me, it was a big 2x4 or whatever it is to get our attention. But here you... There's a verse, one of my favorite verses is in 2 Corinthians. It begins, it says that we've been comforted that we might comfort. Mm. And it always reminds me that part of the reasons that we go through things is so that we're able to help others who go through similar things. Mm. Others who've been brought up in the church that just never got it for whatever reason, you know. But God's trying to reach him. And maybe that your own story is. There's someone out there that they've been brought up through, you know, maybe... They look on the outside, and a person would think that they're a perfect Catholic. Everything looks great on the outside, but what's going on?
What's going on in here?
Right. Here.
What's going on below the iceberg, as Peckerman, pastor of the Evangelical Church, would say. It's interesting, in the book of Acts, right, if you look, I think it's around chapter 9, maybe 22, 23, I'm not sure exactly where, but just Paul basically tells his story three different times. It's his story. It's his, it's his legacy. And what an incredible witness that is. So I would encourage anyone who, you know, who's Catholic and has gone through a similar thing, tell your story. I mean, Mary Ann telling her story to me was instrumental in getting me back to the faith. And I would encourage anyone, you know, who maybe walked away from the Catholic Church and is going through a similar thing, having these questions, maybe consider that maybe God is calling you back home. It's possible.
We got an email. Sylvia from Iowa writes, why do so many Protestants think that they need to evangelize Catholics? We all believe in Jesus and are Christians, so I don't understand why so many feel the need to witness to us Catholics and get us saved.
Right, that's a great question. And again, it comes down to interpretation of the Bible. So we have four Gospels, right? The words of Jesus Christ. And if you extract one or two or three or four different verses from that, and that is basically your entire ecclesiology is based around that. If you're not following this particular formula, then you're obviously not saved.
From their perspective,
it's a very confusing thing. You know, I mean, if you're brought up and raised that way to believe that, then it's, and it, again, I always had this thing, who's saved, who isn't saved? It's such a personal thing. I mean, there are people in the Catholic Church, I don't know where everyone's going to end up. It's not up for me to judge. You know, there is only one judge. That's also scriptural. And, you know, when someone tells you when you're 13, 14, 15 years old, you know, you're going to hell if you don't X, Y, Z in this exact order, what are you going to do? Well, I don't want to go to hell. You know, maybe I got it wrong all along, you know?
Yeah. But you make a good point, and that is this idea of take three or four verses, and then you've established a whole new faith, and that's what happens every day.
That's what happens.
Either end up health, wealth, gospel, or you can end up Pentecostal, or you've got the Lutherans and the Calvinists and the Methodists all have a different view of what are, you know, focused on all those five groups I've just mentioned, health and wealth, you know, the Pentecostal, Lutheran, Calvinist, all love Jesus Christ.
Yes.
And all love the scriptures, you
right.
know. So, I mean, the core is there, but yet, you don't put an emphasis on this verse or that verse. And so it isn't just that people are out to evangelize Catholics.
Mm-hmm.
People are out to evangelize other groups that don't quite see the emphasis on this verse.
Right.
That's so key for that group.
Yeah. Right. And I know, and Catholics especially are separate from all that, because they might they might disagree in a few things, but boy, you can't be Catholic.
Well, and part of it is that right. they would see Catholics are buying into things that aren't in the Bible at all.
Right.
And there's this idea, this assumption that it's got to be in the Bible.
Right.
We got another long email here. Let's see if I can get this whole thing. As Matthew from Delaware writes, I just became Catholic and am so blessed in my new faith. I've been taken aback, though, by the vehement rejection I've experienced from several people in my former church and even by a few members of my family as I've gone through RCIA. They think I've gone off the deep end. Is there a chance they will ever come around? I hate to lose these relationships, but don't know what I could have done differently since I believe the Catholic Church is the fullness of truth. Now, Jay, do you relate to that at all?
Yeah, I you know, again, and like I said, I have some dear friends, brothers and sisters that are of different denominations, and I love them. I know they love the Lord, and we can agree on that, and that's wonderful. And we can agree to disagree on the others. You know, and even Pat Goodman, I went out to coffee with him right before I was making this decision. I said, Pat, what do I do? You know, and he said, you got to do what's right for your family. You know, he didn't say, don't go with those crazy Catholics. I think the most important thing we can do is pray for them. You know, this is something I always, for years, said, I'm going to pray for you, I'm going to pray for you. I never did that. Now, I pray for people. I do pray for people. I actually do what I said I was going to do for all these years. I think it's important. I would encourage, was it Matthew?
Yeah.
Just pray for these brothers and sisters and ask them to pray for you. You know, we have a God that is much bigger and much stronger than we are as human beings. And say, listen, and I've said this to people before, if you really think that I'm going to hell and I'm on the wrong path, my goodness, pray for me. You know, just pray for him. Pray that God would change my heart, because my heart is telling me differently, you know? And I believe it's the Holy Spirit in me leading me in that direction. But pray for me. I'll pray for you. You know, it's interesting. I did the March for Life in January, and first time I knew you pack a bus full of Catholics, you know, the rosary's going to come up. So I was like, all right, you know, I wasn't ready for that necessarily. And, you know, just meditating on the sorrowful mysteries. And going through that, and I always had a hard time entering into prayer, and for the first time in a long time, and again, there was more conviction. I had this sudden love for children and the unborn. Like, it's just amazing what just a proper devotion to Mary can really do, and how it just always circles right back around to being at the foot of the cross, and. The prayer is such an important part of our walk. I mean, that's how we commune with God, you know, apart from the sacraments. So I would encourage him just to pray.
And I mean, I would never, never for a second discount the importance of prayer at all. But also with that is for Matthew and all of us to make sure that our friends see in us Jesus.
Yes.
They must see that we Catholics, it's about Jesus.
Yeah.
Even our devotion to Mary is about Jesus. You know, our convictions in the church are about Jesus. The church is about Jesus Christ.
Right.
That's what it's about. And they need to see that and know that and hear that from us.
At the center of that altar is Christ on the cross. And that you can't get around that. There's no way around that. And there's just no way.
We have another email from Howard. He writes, I have a good friend who is an evangelical who takes his faith seriously. He keeps committing and recommitting his life to Jesus every time he falls into sin. He's a sincere fellow, but doesn't seem to have the tools to really break the habits of a sinful life. I thought about telling him about the Catholic sacraments and how they give us grace to turn from sin, but I'm not sure where to begin or to explain it in a way that he'll understand.
Well, I think his testimony would be the greatest witness. You know, how did it work in my life?
Yeah. And
because again, I can't tell people, you know, I spent a lot of time trying to tell people this is the formula you need, but I had no explanation for how it worked in my life because it didn't necessarily work. So now I can tell you, people have said to me, Jay, you're different. I notice a change in you. You know, I think even my wife would agree that I'm not the same person I was before. And it's possible to find Jesus in all these various different denominations. I found him in the Catholic Church again, you know, in a way that I should have as a Protestant. So
you did make a comment
earlier
in your journey that I want to come back to. I'm not sure you want me to dredge up these old parts of your life.
Dredge away.
No, you had mentioned that there was an earlier relationship where your private lives were not all that hot. Then you turn around and go to church the next.
Yeah.
Okay. And I don't want to dredge into that, but mm-hmm. I want to get to that because that's kind of what I think this guy's talking about is, on the one hand, there's an issue of grace that empowers us to be different. Certainly, our Lord calls us to be holy and perfect as Heavenly Father is perfect. But it isn't because we have so much gumption and ability to do that. It's because grace empowers us, even to open our mind to want to be different. So grace. But there is another side of our theology affects us.
Mm-hmm.
And sadly, some of the once saved, always saved theology can feed us with an unfounded security that thinks it really doesn't matter what I do with my life.
And that's so true. Yeah. But again, if you truly do love Jesus Christ, you see, this is what Hebrews says, right? Faith without works is dead. Like, works are the fruit of our faith. So I believe if we're truly sold out for Jesus, a natural byproduct of that knowledge of Christ is going to be the works. And it's going to reflect in how you, and it's not an overnight change necessarily, but it comes from conviction and discipline and a healthy fear of the Lord. I'm not doubting that this man has that, but I could say for my personal self, I don't necessarily know whether I had that for a while. You know, I just, again, adopted the culture.
And as Catholics, you know, one thing we recognize is that just because I was baptized or because I've been to Mass or because I've done all these things, even I've been to confession, does not mean I've arrived and I can rest back and, you know, that I know one day I'll be saved just because I did these things. No, it's a day by day living in grace, surrendering to Christ. And so we know we're called to walk in holiness with our Lord by His grace. Other theologies can give an assumption that, well, because I said this sinner's prayer 15 years ago at a crusade, then I've arrived, I'm saved.
Right.
Even if I fall, because the idea in that theology is that Christ died for all my sins, past, present, and future, there's nothing to do, they're forgiven. Mm-hmm. Well, that can make a person talk themselves into doing things they know they shouldn't
right.
do.
Right, contrary to that, if you forget that's where it began. That is the foundation of grace.
Yeah.
You know, then you become too ritualistic and believing that you have to go through these steps. So again, it's a healthy balance of both, like knowing that Christ did die for us sins, past, present, and future. But at the same time, we still need to stand righteous before Him.
That's right. That's right. We may have time for one more email.
Okay.
Anna from Illinois. A family who used to go to my parish has started attending a mega church that they tell me has wonderful preaching and a great musical ministry, but what could I do to encourage them to come back to the Catholic Church? We don't have any of the great trappings of that great mega church.
I still have people come up to me, oh, you should check out our church. We got this great program for the kids and the music's awesome. You know, and honestly, one of the reasons I walked away from my church was that was just too much for me. I was attending business conferences. I just started a business. And I felt like a lot of the things I was hearing in the business conference were things I would hear in a church service. And I didn't know if they were getting ideas from the, or vice versa, you know what I mean? And it just felt like it was a little watered down. And there is actually a mega Catholic church near us. And it's wonderful, you know, but again, I wasn't interested in that. I was looking for more of a smaller body of believers. I don't know, that could be a cultural thing. Yeah. I don't know how you, I don't know. Yeah. I don't know how you...
We've run out of time, but you know, the core is what we have, regardless of whether we got all the programs on any one given parish, we've got Jesus on the altar. I mean, that's the key. Jay, thank you very much.
Marcus, thanks for having me.
It's a great pleasure to have you here, and God bless you and your family. And thank you for joining us on this episode of The Journey Home. I do pray that Jay's journey is an encouragement to you. God bless you. See you again next week.